This episode of Yesterworld is in part sponsored by NordVPN. As an addition to your amazing support on Patreon, they continue to also support the channel with every additional signup, and are still offering 77% off a 3-year plan by using code Yesterworld at nordvpn.com/yesterworld. On December 25th, 1955, Disneyland introduced a new attraction to the recently opened theme park, the Mike Fink Keelboats, and the attraction would go on to inspire versions in both the Magic Kingdom and eventually Disneyland Paris. But today, only traces remain of the original Mike Fink Keelboats and its Disney World counterpart. So let's explore the history of this lesser-known attraction and what ultimately led to its eventual demise. On October 27th, 1945, the first episode of Walt Disney's Disneyland series made its debut on television, and would tell stories relating to the 5 planned main lands of the in-development theme park.
Later on in the show, you'll find that Disneyland the place and Disneyland the TV show are all part of the same.
To represent Frontierland, Walt Disney chose to create a 3-part miniseries telling the story of the real-life folk hero and frontiersman, Davy Crockett. And that December, Davy Crockett made his television debut on the 8th episode of the Disneyland series, and his story would be concluded with the 3rd episode in February of 1955, in which, as happened in real life, he was one of the many lives taken during the fight of the Alamo.
In tribute to this great American folk hero, we now present the 3rd story in the Crockett trilogy.
The 3-part series was an unanticipated and unprecedented success, with the popularity of Davy Crockett leading to the production of a massive line of merchandise that included virtually every product imaginable. And within 8 months of what was hailed as the Davy Crockett craze, over $300 million worth of merchandise had been sold, or close to a whopping $3 billion today, and would also be heavily integrated into Disneyland when the park opened in July of 1955.
Now here comes the frontier. And of course, who would be up near the front but Davy Crockett?
It wasn't long after Disneyland's grand opening that, due to public demand, production began on 2 additional episodes of Davy Crockett, which would focus on his legends and exploits to account for his death at the Alamo. The first of which was Davy Crockett's Keelboat Race, in which the iconic frontiersman took part in a race against Mike Fink, King of the River. And it's believed that during the production of this episode, Walt Disney had the idea to utilize these fully functioning boats as a new attraction at Disneyland. So the keelboats underwent a quick refurbishment to add windows and seats for visitors. And on Christmas Day, a little over a month after the episode aired on television, the Mike Fink keelboats made their debut at Disneyland, in which guests could either ride in Davy Crockett's Bertha May or Mike Fink's Gullywumper.
Frontierland tells the story of a young and enterprising nation, and of a people moving westward by riverboat and keelboat.
The ride was instantly popular among guests, as an addition to providing a scenic tour around the rivers of America in the actual keelboats from Davy Crockett, the attraction could be enjoyed at the cost of a C ticket, unlike the Mark Twain riverboat, which required the higher costing D ticket. And for nearly 3 decades, while the screen used original boats would eventually be replaced by fiberglass replicas, the Mike Fink keelboats operated primarily during the busy seasons and occasionally on weekends, and when not in operation, could be found docked along Tom Sawyer Island or the nearby Fowler's Harbor to undergo maintenance.
Come on, sunshine, what can you show me? Where can you take me to make me understand?
By the 1970s, the skipper-narrated attraction proved popular enough that Magic Kingdom debuted its own version when the park opened in 1971, with the 2 keelboats receiving the same names as its Disneyland counterpart, while another incarnation would open alongside Euro Disneyland in 1993. However, back in Disneyland in 1994, as the summer came to an end, the keelboats per usual had their last run until the next busy season or holiday. But this time was different, as the attraction remained closed for the rest of the year and all of 1995. But just as guests began to assume it was shuttered for good, in March of 1996, the keel boats were reopened, but those who welcomed its return wouldn't have long to enjoy the attraction, as barely a year after its reopening, on May 17th, around 5 o'clock p.m., the top level of the Gully Whumper was overloaded with guests beyond its maximum capacity, though it's unclear whether this was by weight or number of guests alone. And shortly after setting off, the keelboat began to rock back and forth, and as the skipper shouted to grab onto something, the Gully Whumper capsized, sending a boatload full of guests into the rivers of America.
I'm sorry, but that didn't build you a stronger ship.
Contrary to popular belief, the accident was not due to the operator's negligence or playing around with the keelboat's throttle, and thankfully, no one was seriously hurt, though a handful of guests were injured enough to warrant treatment at the nearby St. Joseph Hospital, and the keelboats were immediately removed to undergo inspection. But ultimately, those unlucky, or lucky few, would be the final group to ever ride the keelboats, as May 17th would be the last day they would ever operate at Disneyland. And while Magic Kingdom's version would briefly continue operation, in 2001, they would also be permanently closed.
Come back! Come back!
It wasn't long after the closure of Disneyland's keelboats that the Birth of May was added back to the Rivers of America as a display. However, in 2001, the Birth of May was put up on eBay for the asking price of $15,000 and was purchased by a collector named Richard Keith, which appeared in the 2006 documentary Finding Craftland, which was located at a storage facility in La Miranda, California. But in the spring of 2003, the keelboat's other vessel, the Gully Whumper, returned to Disneyland as a prop along the shore banks of the Rivers of America. But unfortunately, little care was given to the Gully Whumper, and by 2008 was only a shadow of its former self, and had actually begun to sink. So during a 2009 refurbishment of Disneyland's iconic river, the keelboat was given a restoration to look just as it appeared in the Davy Crockett television series, and according to Imagineer Tony Baxter, it retained at least the hull of the original. And while the boat would be removed another time for the rerouting of the Rivers of America in preparation for Star Wars Galaxy's Edge, it would return upon its reopening alongside the new Settler's Cabin, appropriately shown to be owned by a certain Mike Fink.
Everybody knows who the captain of the Gully Whumper is. It's me, Mike Fink, King of the River.
Today, the original loading dock for the keelboats at Disneyland, while for a time was used as a smoking area, is now little more than a place to sit down and rest, with Magic Kingdom's loading dock being used to extend the queue of the Haunted Mansion during busy periods. And as far as Euro Disneyland's version of the keelboats, the attraction was closed in the year 2000, and though it was briefly reopened in 2007, it again closed 3 years later and remains in a present state of indefinite limbo. So for the time being, the Mike Fink keelboats exist now only in memory. To avoid missing out on future content, make sure to subscribe and hit the notification bell. And if you want to help support the making of future videos, check out my Patreon and shop in the description. And as always, thank you all so much for watching, and I'll see you next time on Yesterworld.